In this video, we're going to practice using our rules for the derivative and integrals of logarithmic and exponential functions. So let's start here with this example. We're asked to evaluate the derivative with respect to x of the natural log of 2 plus the natural log of x. So first, let's just restate the relevant formulas that we're going to need to approach this problem. So one thing we know, hopefully, is that the derivative of the natural log of x equals 1 over x. And kind of an extension of that is the derivative of some function u of x equals u prime of x over u of x. So notice this second formula here is just an extension of the first one with an application of the chain rule. And that's actually what I'm going to want to do in this case. I have the natural log of some function of x. So then the derivative of this expression is going to be, first of all, 1 over whatever's inside my parentheses here. So that would be 1 over 2 plus natural log of x. Okay, and that's this u of x in the denominator here. But then the chain rule says that I need to multiply by the derivative of the inner function, which in this case is this 2 plus ln x. So I need to multiply by the derivative of 2 plus the natural log of x. Okay, so then that derivative, the derivative of 2 is just 0. The derivative of natural log of x is 1 over x. Okay, so it looks like in the end I have 1 over x times 1 over 2 plus natural log of x as my derivative. In this example, we want to evaluate the derivative with respect to x of pi to the square root of x. Now this is kind of a funky looking expression, so let's try to figure out what exactly is going on here, and then we'll pick the appropriate derivative rule to use. So one thing you might be tempted to do, hopefully not, but some of you might be tempted to use the power rule in this situation, but that is a bad, bad, bad idea. So the power rule applies to situations like x squared. Right? If I were taking the derivative of x squared, I would say it was 2x. But that's different than what we have here. In x squared, my variable is the base, and a number is the exponent. But here, I've got actually the opposite situation. I have a numeric base, and then my exponent is x, or in this case, a function of x. So I do not want to use the power rule here. Instead, I want to use rules for the derivative of a general exponential function. So, maybe you recall that the derivative of an exponential function, b to the x, equals the natural log of b times b to the x. And if we extend that by the chain rule, we can say that the derivative of b to some function of x, I'll call it u of x, equals the natural log of b times b to u of x times the derivative of that inner function, u prime of x. This is what we want to use in this case, right? Because this is the situation we have. We have some base, right here b represents a number. We have some base b raised to some function of x. Okay, so let's apply the rule. So my derivative then should be the natural log of b. My base in this case is pi, so the natural log of pi, times pi to the square root of x, and then times the derivative of the square root of x. So going a step further, I need to take the derivative of the square root of x. Now another way I could write the square root of x is x to the 1/2 power, and now this is something that I do want to use the power rule on. So multiply by that derivative would be 1/2 x to the negative 1/2 power. And we will just leave our answer like this for the purposes of this example. In this example, we're going to look at an integral. So here I have the integral of 1 over x ln x dx. Now, this is not something that I would just be able to apply straightforwardly one of my basic integration formulas. I'm going to need to be a little bit more thoughtful here. So one of our most common ways that we've learned so far of approaching more challenging integrals is by use substitution. And when we use substitution, what we're looking for is we're looking for some quantity whose derivative also appears in the integral. So what I see here is I see a natural log of x in the denominator and also an x in the denominator. And hopefully you remember that the derivative of natural log of x is 1 over x. Okay, so that kind of points us in the right direction. So it looks like we might want to try letting u equal the natural log of x. So if we do that, du is going to be 1 over x dx, which I see in my expression, right? I have a 1 over x dx. So this looks like it's going to work out perfectly for us. So I'm going to end up then with the integral of 1 over u du. Okay, so now I have to evaluate this integral, but hopefully you recognize this form as well. The integral of 1 over u is going to be the natural log of the absolute value of u plus c. So as my very last step, I just need to substitute back so that I'm in terms of x again. So that's going to give me the natural log of the absolute value of the natural log of x plus c as my final answer. Let's take a look at another integral, this time a definite integral. Here I have the definite integral from 0 to 2 of e to the x over the quantity e to the x plus 1 dx. Now, once again, this is a little bit more of a complex integral. It's not something that I can just use one of my basic formulas on. And that suggests that we want to try one of our other methods for evaluating integrals. So let's try use substitution and see if we can get that to work in this case. So I'm going to try letting u equal what I see in the denominator of the fraction. That is e to the x plus 1. So if I do that, then du, the derivative of that expression, is going to be e to the x dx. And that's nice, right, because that's what I see in the top here. I have this factor of e to the x dx that I can easily substitute for. Now, whenever we do a u substitution, if you recall, we need to make sure that we transform everything to be in terms of u, and that includes the bounds of the integral. So let's go ahead and transform those bounds. So my lower bound is x equals 0. I'm going to transform that by just plugging it into this u expression. So then u would equal e to the 0 plus 1. But e to the 0 is 1. So that becomes 2. And then I need to transform my upper bound, x equals 2 as well, by the same method. So I get u equals e squared plus 1. That's nothing nice that we know, so we'll just leave it in that form. So then my new integral becomes the integral from 2 to e squared plus 1 of 1 over u du. So hopefully you know the antiderivative of 1 over u. That's going to be the natural log of the absolute value of u. And I'm evaluating this between 2 and e squared plus 1. So I simply plug in. I get the natural log of e squared plus 1 minus the natural log of 2. And in this case, it would be all right if you wanted to drop those absolute value symbols, since both of these quantities are positive anyway. As our final example, let's look at one that's more challenging than the ones we've seen so far. So here I want to find a derivative. I want to find dy dt for y equals t to the natural log of t. So why is this a challenging example? Well, what's going on here? I have this function, this expression, y equals t to the natural log of t. And if in this expression I see that my base is a variable, and that my exponent is also a variable. So we know some formulas. We know the derivative of b to the x is the natural log of b times b to the x. And we know the power rule, that the derivative of x to the n is n x to the n minus 1. But neither of those situations quite captures what's going on here, right? In this b to the x, my base is a number, my exponent's a variable. And in this form x to the n, my base is a variable, my exponent's a number. But here, both my base and my exponent are variables. So I'm going to have to be a little bit more clever. And actually, there are two ways you can approach this problem. One is called implicit differentiation, and that's a process you learned about in Calculus 1. It's a really good thing to know how to do, and I suggest you review that process if you have time. We're actually going to use a different method today that's going to make use of the log and exponential relationships that we've learned about today. So let's take a look at what we could do here. So first of all, I want you to recall an important fact, and that's the fact that the natural exponential and the natural log functions are inverses. So if I had the expression e to the natural log of x, that would reduce to x, right? Because those functions are inverses. So I'm going to take advantage of that fact to rewrite this expression t ln t. And I'm going to write it like this, e to the natural log of t ln t. And you might wonder why in the world we would want to do that, but you'll see in a second why we want to do this. Right now, just make sure you understand that this is true, right? Because the e and the natural log are inverses, they would cancel each other out, and I just get this t ln t back. Okay, so now, though, Actually, let me back up one step here. I just wrote this in a bad way. This is e to the natural log of t to the ln t power. Right, that ln t should be an exponent. Okay, so now what I can do is I can use the properties of natural log to rewrite this a little bit. I can write this as e to the natural log of t times the natural log of t. What I've done here is I've just taken this power and made it a coefficient. So I could even go a step further and write this e to the natural log of t squared. So now that we have this rewritten, let's try taking the derivative again. So my derivative dy dt is going to be the derivative with respect to t of this new expression. Well, not new expression, but this rewritten expression here. So how would I take the derivative of this expression? Well, hopefully you recall that the derivative of e to the x is e to the x. Now, in this case, I'm going to have to use a chain rule since I have a function of t in my exponent here. But my first step, though, is going to be to have this e to the natural log of t squared, and then I'm going to want to multiply by the derivative of that expression. Okay, so then going forward, I have e to the natural log of t quantity squared, and now I want to work on the derivative of ln t quantity squared. So here I'm going to use the power rule. I'm going to bring down that 2. Okay, so then I'm going to have natural log of t to the first power. But then once again, I have to use a chain rule and multiply by the derivative of the inner function. And the derivative of the natural log of t is 1 over t. So then this whole expression here is my derivative in this case.